Is it on? Oh, now it is. But it's dropping. Do you know how to... Okay, can you hear me? That's awfully loud. All right. So, good afternoon, and good afternoon, right? Yeah, good afternoon. Good. There you go. I'll say it again. Good afternoon. There you go. Very good. So, I'd like to welcome you all to the annual Jonathan Mann Health and Human Rights Memorial Lecture. This is a very important lecture for our school, so I'd like to welcome our faculty, our staff, students, alumni, members of our Dean's Advisory Council, our former Dean, Marla Gold, who's there somewhere, there she is, we're in store for a treat, I know, so thank you for coming. First of all, I'd like to introduce Dr. Walter Cohen. Dr. Cohen is Chancellor Emeritus of Drexel University College of Medicine, and he's former President of the Medical College of Pennsylvania and Dean Emeritus of the School of Dental Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania. And he's a longtime member of the Dean's Advisory Council here at the Dorsey School of Public Health. Dr. Cohen has generously endowed this lecture, the Jonathan Mann Health and Human Rights Memorial Lecture. He will say a few words about Jonathan Mann, a former dean of this school and very important figure in terms of setting the trajectory for the school, which we are continuing and building on today. So join me in welcoming Dr. Cohen.
Thank you, Anna. The entire scientific world was shocked on September 2, 1998, when a Swiss jetliner headed to Geneva, Switzerland, crashed off the coast of Canada. Among the passengers on board were Jonathan Mann and his wife, both highly respected and renowned researchers who were headed to the United Nations AIDS Vaccine Conference. Jonathan Mann had held many high-level positions at the CDC before establishing the World Health Organization's Global Program on AIDS, which he ran from 1986 to 1990. Jonathan Mann was born in Boston in 1947. He was the second of four children born to Dr. James Mann and Ida Mann. His father was a well-known psychoanalyst who had received his medical degree from Washington University Medical School. His mother was trained as a social worker and for many years worked in that profession. Jonathan followed his sister Carol by going to Harvard. Being a very determined young man, he ran in the Boston Marathon. Jonathan received his BA from Harvard in 1968, and he married Marie Paula Bondat, whom he had met when studying political science in Paris during his junior year. They had three children, twins Naomi and Lydia and Aaron. Lydia we got to know as she has attended several previous Jonathan Mann lectures here at Drexel. In 1974, Dr. Mann received his medical degree from the Washington University School of Medicine. He had entered medical school with the intention of becoming an ophthalmologist. However, he soon became interested in public health, and after graduating, he and Marie Paula went to New Mexico, where he worked as an epidemiologist for the CDC. He and Marie Paula shared many interests that they were able to pursue while in New Mexico. He later moved to the state's health department, where he stayed for 10 years and was credited with helping to control the bubonic plague. Mann headed the WHO AIDS program until 1990. During his tenure, tremendous strides were made in the war against AIDS. Daniel Tarantola, who joined the endeavor at the beginning, recalled later that, and I quote, "The program was himself, Mann, a secretary, and one typewriter." end quote. 2 years later, Mann had managed to build a budget of almost $100 million. One of the first initiatives was the establishment of the Global Commission on AIDS, composed of a mix of epidemiologists, scientists, and ethicists. It included Luc Montagnier of France and Robert Gallo of the United States, rivals in the claim for isolating the virus. Also on the commission were June Osborne, then professor of public health at Michigan University, and one of Mann's closest friends. Richard Rector, a person living with HIV/AIDS, Mann insisted on his presence on the commission, and a token lawyer, the Honorable Justice Michael Kirby from the High Court of Australia. Kirby later commented that he would never forget the energy with which Jonathan Mann threw himself into the struggle, surely beyond the capacities of any single human being. On his remarkable mixture of cold logic and passionate call to arms, or his clinical mobilization of hand-won epidemiological experience leavened by the demands for respect for human rights, which seemed to resonate deeply within him, and to take equal strength from his American and his Jewish identification, or his brilliant skill in answering tricky questions, alternatively in English and French, paying courtesy to the interlocutors in each of the principal languages of the United Nations. In a dazzling display of high intelligence, skilled professionalism, and absolute dedication. Mann's determination to respect each individual, his dogged moral conviction that effectively countered every government's denial of the existence of AIDS among their people, and his denouncement of inhumane policies inflicted upon people with HIV. In 1995, Mann married Mary Lou Clements, a highly respected researcher in her own right, while working on an expert committee that was developing new strategies to fight disease. They were married in 1996. In 1998, Dr. Mann was appointed dean of the school, which was unfortunately short-lived. I had the privilege of getting to know him and Mary Lou. He was a warm, bright, compassionate academician with great plans for the school, which he never had the chance to implement. One connection that still remains, he designed the pin that is given to new students here each year. He will be remembered as a champion for human rights in the fight against AIDS. And I want to thank Dean Emerita Marley Gold for her help in my preparing these remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Walter. I should mention that in a testament to Jonathan Mann's vision of a school that really thinks of health as a human right and recognizes the importance of social justice to health, we award our graduating students the Declaration of Human Rights at graduation in addition to their diplomas. So this is very much part of the way we think about public health. And so, given this, it's really hard to imagine a more appropriate speaker for a Jonathan Mann Health and Human Rights Memorial Lecture than Camara Jones. Dr. Jones received her bachelor's in molecular biology from Wellesley College and then an MD from Stanford University. And she subsequently completed a residency in preventive medicine at Johns Hopkins, where she also obtained a master's of public health at the then Johns Hopkins School of Hygiene and Public Health. Not done with that, she went on to get a second residency. And those of you who have done a residency know what this means. So she went on to complete a second residency in family practice in the social medicine program at Montefiore Medical Center in New York. And this was really a pioneering program that sought to train physicians with a social determinants of health lens long before talking about social determinants was fashionable or common. So a truly pioneering program. I remember hearing about this program as a pediatric resident in Argentina. So quite an impact. She then returned to Hopkins to complete her PhD in epidemiology. And there, I had the good fortune to cross paths with Camara. That's where I met her. And at the time, she and I were reminiscing, she hung out with the biostatisticians. So all you biostatisticians out there and biostatistics students, studying biostatistics can take you in a lot of different directions, which is great, right? So she hung out with a lot. In fact, for a long time, I thought Camara was getting her PhD in biostatistics, not in epidemiology at all. I would see her in this place called the Fishbowl, which was where we had these mainframe computers that we had to do all. We didn't have the. This was not that long ago. It was, you know, it was a while ago, but it was not that long ago. It's like ancient history now, but and Camara did her dissertation on, and I remember hearing her present on this, our methods for, she worked on innovative and really cool, I should add, methods for comparing distributions. And you might think, well, why is that important? Well, actually, it's very important because this whole idea of comparing distributions as opposed to averages is really central to public health and to population health and to health disparities. After finishing her dissertation, she was on the faculty at the Harvard School of Public Health in the Department of what was then called Health and Social Behavior. And her research on racism and health took her to New Zealand, where she discovered her power. And I'll let her explain that if she wants to later during her talk. So after 6 years at Harvard, she joined the Center for Disease Control, where she worked for 14 years, and she was until last year, and she was a research director on the social determinants of health and equity at the National Center for Chronic Disease Prevention and Health Promotion. I'm sure that when Camara went to CDC again, this idea of social determinants, research on social, was quite new. So currently, she is a senior fellow at the Satcher Health Leadership Institute and at the Cardiovascular Research Institute at the Morehouse College School of Medicine. And last but not least, she is currently president of the American Public Health Association. So not a small feat. So Camara has really been a leader in the movement to incorporate social determinants of health, social determinants of health perspective, not only into research, but also I want to emphasize into public health practice and what that really means for the practice of public health and for policy more generally. And her work on race-associated differences in health goes beyond describing these differences to really investigating the structural causes of these differences. And as a teacher, and I'm sure you'll see her many, her outstanding qualities as a teacher, she uses allegories on race and racism to generate insight and illuminating discussion. And so I'm delighted to welcome Camara to the Dornsife School of Public Health and also to deliver the Jonathan Mann Lecture today.
Thank you, Anna. We knew each other as students, and now here she is dean. This is just like amazing to me. So I am so delighted to be here. I also met Jonathan Mann just briefly while I was a professor, an assistant professor at the Harvard School of Public Health. And I remember that day in September when we got the news of that plane crash, and it devastated all of us. So I am so honored to be here at the school that he was launching. I observe already from my meetings with faculty members and students and alumni during this day the commitment to social justice, and I'm honored to be here to deliver this Jonathan Mann Memorial Lecture. My topic today is about achieving health equity with a specific focus on naming, measuring, and addressing racism as a threat to the health and well-being of the nation. And I hope today to provide all of us with tools for a national conversation on racism that actually will evolve into a national campaign against racism. To start with, though, and I actually, oh, here. To start with, I'm not going to jump right in on racism because that might be a bit much for people, right? I mean, I understand where I am. So to start with, I'm actually going to frame this conversation about racism with a description of different levels of health intervention. And I'm going to illustrate these levels of health intervention with what I call my cliff analogy. It's a cartoon animation. So here we go. Do, 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 do. Whoops! Boom! Somebody just fell off of the cliff of good health. And if that were you or somebody in your family, you would be delighted to find an ambulance at the bottom of the cliff to speed you on to care. But if we were concerned about others who might come along that cliff face, if we were concerned about public health, population health, community health, we might well ask ourselves, what can we put in place as a health intervention besides just stationing lots of ambulances at the bottom of the cliff? So somebody in this room is going to say, I know, let's have a net halfway down because, you know, even if people fall, we can catch them before they get crunched up at the bottom. And that's an excellent idea. Although when you think about it, you know, nets do have holes in them, so some people might fall through the cracks. But we could even make that a trampoline halfway down that cliff. No holes in a trampoline. But even if we have a trampoline halfway down the cliff, you know, we might find ourselves with lots of people just bouncing up and down at half functionality, not able to get back to the top of the cliff. So what else can we put in place as a health intervention? Well, clearly we need to be thinking about a fence at the edge of the cliff to keep people from falling in the first place. But that's got to be a very, very strong fence if there's a lot of population pressure against it. So what else can we do as a health intervention? Well, we can move the population away from the edge of the cliff. So I'm going to label the interventions that I've described so far, where the ambulance at the bottom of the cliff clearly represents medical care and tertiary prevention. So here we are, public health folks, and we know that we talk about these three levels of prevention, primary, secondary, tertiary, where tertiary prevention is preventing complications from disease that's already manifest. For example, preventing amputations from diabetes and the like. So that's your ambulance. Your net or trampoline halfway down. These are safety net programs, which can be in our social services, as well as secondary prevention, which is about early detection, screening programs, cancer screening and the like. The fence represents primary prevention, keeping things from happening in the first place, which can be in terms of policy interventions or even things like immunizations. And moving the population away from the edge of the cliff is what we now describe as addressing the social determinants of health. Addressing those determinants of health that are outside of the individual. They're beyond our genes and beyond our individual behaviors, and in fact are the context in which our behaviors arise. And so these social determinants of health, of course, include your individual resource context like poverty or wealth, education, income, all of that. They also include neighborhood context. So whether or not it's safe for you to walk in your neighborhood. Are there sidewalks? Are there streetlights? Are the police officers hunting down you or your children? Whether or not you can get 5 to 9 servings of fresh fruits and vegetables in your neighborhood. Are there jobs? And even if there aren't jobs, can you get transportation to another neighborhood where there are jobs? What are the schools like? What are the environmental hazards? What kinds of things are you encountering on your job if you can get one at all? So all of that's the social determinants of health. And in fact, when you think about these levels of health intervention that I've described so far, and we were thinking about infant mortality, for example, the ambulance might be our neonatal intensive care units. And the net or trampoline halfway down, these might be prenatal care, early detection. The fence might be WIC programs, excellent maternal nutrition, so our women, infants, and children programs. Moving the population might be a living wage or excellent educational opportunities so that young girls didn't have babies so soon. And it's a nice little diagram that could actually start a conversation in this room today or in any community group about how should we be spending our health resources. Because we all recognize we need some of all of this, but it's a matter of emphasis. So how much in ambulances versus nets versus fences versus moving the population? We could go to Congress and have a conversation. But you know, as useful as this diagram could be, it has a huge fatal flaw so far. Where the huge fatal flaw is that it doesn't yet talk about how health disparities arise. So let's keep the cliff in the back of our minds, but we're going to shift gears for just a moment to talk about how health disparities arise on three levels, and then we'll come back to the cliff. So how do health disparities arise? Well, especially when we're talking about racial ethnic health disparities, which have a long and persistent history in our nation's presence in our nation's history, we, in 2002-2003, got word through the Institute of Medicine about differences in the quality of care received within the healthcare system when they published their unequal treatment report, which pulled together what were then hundreds of studies documenting that even if you're all treated in the VA system or everybody covered by Medicare or Medicaid, everybody in the same health system, there were differences, for example, in how vigorously your chest pain might be investigated, depending on your race, or differences in how much pain medication you would get if you walked into an emergency department with a long bone fracture, depending on your ethnicity. But that IOM panel that wrote that report said it's not just what happens within the healthcare system, because, of course, there are many people who can't even access healthcare in the first place. But then we in this room should know that health is not created within the health sector, so there's a third level at which health disparities arise, which are differences in the conditions of our lives, differences in our life opportunities, exposures, and stresses, which are making some individuals and communities sicker than others in the first place. And when you think about these three levels at which health disparities arise, differences in quality of care, differences in access to care, and differences in underlying exposures and opportunities, you can think of it as a pyramid. Or better yet, we could think of it as an iceberg, where the huge hidden base are the differences in the quality of our lives. And then you have the very same people who are made sicker, the same ones who are sometimes frustrated because of limited access to the healthcare system. And then even the lucky ones who get into the system are sometimes further injured because of differences in quality of care. So now thinking about these three levels at which health disparities arise, we're going to go back to the cliff. But now we're going to recognize that actually we're not dealing with a flat two-dimensional cliff, but we're dealing with a three-dimensional cliff. And at some parts of the cliff, there might be an ambulance there, but maybe that ambulance has a flat tire, so it's slow or goes off in the wrong direction. Or maybe there's no ambulance there at all, and maybe there's no net nor fence, and usually at those parts of the cliff, the population is being pushed closer to the edge. So now we're going to label these observations about the three-dimensional cliff with how health disparities arise. Where the differences in quality of care, that's when the ambulance is there, but it's slower, goes off in the wrong direction. Differences in access to care are no ambulance, no net, no fence. And differences in underlying exposures and opportunities are represented by the closer proximity of that greeny population to the edge. So now that we recognize that we're dealing with a three-dimensional cliff, there's a whole new set of questions that arise. The first, of course, being, how did the cliff become three-dimensional in the first place? And that's usually because of historical injustices that are being perpetuated by present-day contemporary structural factors. But given that the cliff is three-dimensional, we also need to ask, why are there differences in how resources are distributed along that cliff face? And why are there differences in who's found at different parts of the cliff? And when you start asking and addressing these kinds of questions, you are now doing what I describe as addressing the social determinants of equity, which differ from the social determinants of health. You remember I described addressing the social determinants of health as moving the population away from the edge of the cliff, addressing things like poverty and neighborhood context and the like. But these social determinants of equity are systems of power that can distribute resources and populations, and these include racism, sexism, heterosexism, economic systems like capitalism and the like. And actually, with this cliff, I have distilled three different dimensions, if you will, of health intervention. And if you go back to your junior high or high school geometry, where one dimension is a line, two dimensions is a flat plane, three dimensions is space, well, along the line at the edge of the cliff is where we can display all of our health services. Our curative and preventive health services are right here. In fact, all of the conversation we've had since 2009 about the Affordable Care Act has been a discussion about this part of the cliff. And in fact, I would hope that everybody in this room would endorse the notion that we need universal access to high-quality health care, right? But even if we got that, that would not solve the whole problem. That would not, in and of itself, result in large and sustained improvements in health outcomes or the elimination of health disparities. The reason that we need universal access to high-quality health care is because that is how a civilized society values all of its people equally, right? But as wonderful as your healthcare system is, we can overwhelm any system if everybody's crowded up against the edge of it. So we have to move into that second dimension, which we can display in a flat plane. We have to address the social determinants of health, including poverty and adverse neighborhood conditions and the like, if we're going to achieve large and sustained improvements in health outcomes. We have to move the population away from the edge of the cliff. But if we do that, here's the trick. If we move the population away from the edge of the cliff without recognizing that we're really dealing with a three-dimensional cliff, we're at risk of moving some of the population and not all of the population and actually making health disparities worse. So we need to acknowledge and address the three-dimensionality of the cliff. We need to address the social determinants of equity, including racism, sexism, heterosexism, and the like, if we want to achieve social justice and eliminate health disparities. And so in this cliff analogy, sometimes I just use it, and then I say, well, you know, I've already said the word racism about two or three times and nobody fell out of their chair, so let's go, you know. So I sometimes just use this to introduce this, but it's an important understanding. It's an important understanding that as interested as we've been for years in addressing poverty and all the like, it's important to do that, but we must also address the mechanisms of institutionalized racism and other systems of structured inequity. That is part of our health enterprise. It's not just extra or icing on the cake, if we want to do this. It's also important, if you are, there are those of you in the room who are trying to be the best ambulance driver you can be, say you're a medical student or a physician, that's important. We need you there, but you also need to know about all this other stuff that is actually helping out your enterprise. And even if your day job is to be the best ambulance driver you can be, as a citizen, we all need to be addressing all of these other aspects. And in fact, when you think about what happened in Flint, Michigan, where the community was crying out, the water looks bad, it tastes bad, look at the color, my hair is falling out, I'm getting boils on my skin, and they were calling for action. Pediatricians were starting to notice elevated lead levels in the patients. And they didn't say, oh, there goes another one. But they joined with community. And it took 19 months. But after 19 months, then the situation of the poisoning of the water and the people in Flint, Michigan came to national attention. And it's not solved yet, I have to say. The water supply was switched back to Lake Huron, the water, Detroit water supply, but those pipes are still so corroded, and you need to know, even though it's fallen off the national news, people there are still getting toxic waste out of their pipes, and the problem is not yet solved. But this is just an example that all of us need to be involved in all of it. So now I'm going to shift specifically, with that kind of warm-up, if you will, I'm going to shift specifically now to address racism, which is one of those social determinants of equity. And when I say the word racism, I'm very clear that I'm talking about a system. I am not talking about an individual character flaw or a personal moral failing or even a psychiatric illness, as some people have suggested, but I'm talking about a system of power. And a system of doing what? It's a system of structuring opportunity and of assigning value. And on what basis is the opportunity structured and on what basis is the value assigned? It's based on the social interpretation of how we look, which is what we call race in this country. Now, for those of you who grew up in this country, you're like, what is she saying? Race is the social interpretation of how one looks. What did she mean by that? Because we, if you grew up here, you think you just look at somebody and you know their race, right? But if you moved to this country from outside, you know you had to learn how to make the appropriate distinctions. Furthermore, if you have traveled outside of this country, then you very well may have gone to some other place, no matter what you look like, gone to some other place where your race was different from what you thought. For example, I live in Atlanta, Georgia, and there, as probably in Philadelphia, I am clearly black. But I've also had the experience of being in some parts of Brazil where I am just as clearly white. I've been in South Africa where I've been clearly colored, and here I am, same physical appearance in those three settings, but the social interpretation of my appearance in those three settings assigns me to three different racial groups. And furthermore, if I were to stay in any of those settings long enough, my health outcome would probably take on that of the group to which I've been assigned, even though I'd have the same genes in all three places. So anyway, so I'm describing race as the social interpretation of how one looks, and racism as the system of structuring opportunity and assigning value based on this so-called race. Well, what are the impacts of this system? Well, when we think or talk about racism at all, which is not very frequently in this country, but when we do, we understand that it unfairly disadvantages some individuals and communities. But it doesn't take very long to recognize that every unfair disadvantage has its reciprocal unfair advantage, so that racism is also unfairly advantaging other individuals and communities. And that's the whole issue of unearned white privilege that we hardly ever talk about. And I know that my saying these words just now have made some people squirm, so I want you to come back. I want you to come back with me, right? I know it's hard, and actually, I'm going to share with you an allegory by the end of our time together, which will make it very clear for even you to start a conversation about unearned white privilege. But then even as we recognize, okay, we have a system that's either unfairly disadvantaging or unfairly advantaging individuals and communities, racism is also sapping the strength of the whole society through the waste of human resources. And there are many examples that I can give of that. So I'm just going to give two right now for the sake of time. The first, very importantly, is how we as a nation are not vigorously investing in the full, excellent public education of all of our children, because the blinders of racism that we have on make us think that there's no genius in the barrios or in the ghettos or on the reservations. You know, we can get along very well, thank you, without those children. But of course, there's genius in all of our communities. And if we would just fully invest in that genius, we could be doing so much better as a nation or even as a world. We could be already up on Mars farming if that were a good idea. Right? Right? And even beyond that, we wouldn't even have to go up to Mars. We could already be solving the problems in our communities today if we were to invest in all of that genius. Another example of how racism saps the strength of the whole society is how these blinders that don't value all of us equally have made us as a nation complacent with what I describe as the wholesale warehousing, disproportionately, of so many black and brown men in the prison system, as if that did not separate us from human potential. And if you know people who are either stuck in the prisons or cycling in and out, because when you come out, in many states can't vote, can't get a job, can't get public housing in many states, then you know that there are geniuses. If you know any of these people, there are geniuses caught up in this system that, if there had only been some other way, could be contributing quite productively to our society. And we even now have to try to reclaim that genius. Even when we have the opportunities, we are not actively trying to reclaim that genius. And in fact, of all of these three bullets that I have here about the impacts of racism, it's important to call out the unfair disadvantage and its reciprocal unfair advantage. But I think that that third bullet about how racism saps the strength of the whole society is perhaps the most important thing up on that slide. Because, and you know, there's students in here. I'm going to challenge you all. I challenge you to think about ways of doing research to measure that impact. I challenge any media in here to have more media stories about how racism is sapping the strength of the whole society. We all need to have more conversations around our dinner tables about this, because to that extent, we will engage more people with understanding and urgency in dismantling this system and putting in its place a system in which all people can know and develop to their full potentials. But you say, this is a nice definition, Camara, I understand it's a system and all that, but how could racism turn into a health outcome? How could racism turn into differences in asthma prevalence, or differences in obesity prevalence, or heart disease, or even cancer mortality rates? And when you think about that, I find it quite useful to think about racism on three levels: institutionalized, personally mediated, and internalized. So I'll define each of these, provide examples, and then illustrate them with my gardener's tale allegory. And I'm very well aware that every student in this room has heard the gardener's tale. I'd like to know who all of you guys who know the gardener's tale already, please raise your hand. So that's a wonderful audience. So there are some of you who do not. My challenge to all of those who have heard the gardener's tale or read it is to listen with new ears so that you can figure out the nuances to tell it back. Okay? But first, let me define these three levels of racism before I illustrate them. So institutionalized racism, that's the system, if you will. That's the constellation of structures and policies and practices and norms and values that results in differential access to the goods, services, and opportunities of society by race. This is the kind of racism that doesn't require an identifiable perpetrator, because it's been institutionalized in the laws and the customs and the background norms. In fact, we often see it as inherited disadvantage or its reciprocal inherited advantage. It manifests in terms of material conditions, as well as in terms of access to power. So examples include differential access to quality housing by race, or differential access to excellent educational opportunities, or equal income, or equal employment, or even the same level of income at the same level of employment. And these things clearly impact health. Differential access to medical facilities, including linguistic access. Differential access to a clean environment. I used to talk about the disproportionate placement of toxic dump sites or bus transfer stations in communities of color, and now I just lift up Flint, Michigan. My. Differential access to power, which could be information as power, could be health information, or even information about our own histories. Power as resources, not just capital resources, but social networking resources, knowing somebody on the board, and power as voice in media and government and the like. Now, I want to lift up one point that, under my example, sometimes I've been asked, Dr. Jones, would you look at that top bullet there, housing, education, employment, and income? Isn't that what we call social class? So why do you have that on a slide about racism? Are you talking about racism, or are you really, really, really talking about social class? And I know that there's some of you who are saying, yes, please answer that for me. So I will. And my answer starts with the observation that it doesn't just so happen that people of color in this country are overrepresented in poverty, while white people in this country are overrepresented in wealth. That's not just a happenstance. And for each marginalized or stigmatized or oppressed group of color, there's been some initial historical insult. So for American Indians, it was the taking of the land and the near genocide, and then the moving of the survivors to reserve lands, reservations, and in some instances, something good was found under one reservation. Oops, you gotta pick them up and move them somewhere else. We could talk for many groups, you know, for years, it would centuries, people who lived in Mexico all of a sudden found that they were living in New Mexico, or in Texas, or California. No, they didn't move across the border moved across them, and yet their children are still being harassed on the streets, right? We could talk about Chinese laborers who came to build our railroads, unable to bring their wives and unable to marry. Japanese citizens who were interned during World War II. People of African descent. That whole thing started with the kidnapping of West African people and then our importation across the Atlantic with tremendous loss of life in the Middle Passage. And then for the survivors and their progeny, what I describe as the coerced usury of our unpaid labor for centuries to build this country. But then some people say, oh, Dr. Jones, there you go, talking about slavery. And Dr. Jones, we know that slavery was an unfortunate chapter in our nation's history. But Dr. Jones, the enslaved people were emancipated by 1865, and it is now 2016, so that's now 151 years. ago. So all else being equal, don't you think the impacts of slavery would have washed out by now, they ask me. But the key phrase there is all else being equal, and all else has not been equal since 1865, and all else still is not equal today. And there are still what I describe as contemporary structural factors that are perpetuating each of these initial historical injustices. And these contemporary structural factors are part and parcel of what we call institutionalized racism. So when you ask, am I talking about racism or am I talking about social class, my response is that institutionalized racism explains why we even see an association between social class and race in this country. And that's a huge aha. Because what it means is, I know it's important for us to eradicate poverty across this land. I would go further. I would eliminate income inequality. My husband and I disagree on that, but I would. I would flatten the whole thing out. Give me a magic wand today, here, choom, 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 okay, done, right? But if I had that power and if I could do that, which I would do it today, if I did it without addressing the background structures, policies, practices, norms, and values, the background mechanisms of institutionalized racism that were put in place to differentially shunt different populations into different possibilities. If I eliminated poverty or eliminated income inequality without addressing institutionalized racism, then in 20 years, in one generation, we would start to see a stratification by race in terms of income again. And that's an important realization. And before I leave institutionalized racism, I want to say one more thing, which is that it can be through acts of doing, acts of commission, as well as acts of not doing, acts of omission. And very often, institutionalized racism shows up as inaction in the face of need. The second level of racism, personally mediated racism, I define as differential assumptions about the abilities, motives, and intents of others by race, and then differential actions based on those assumptions. That's what most people think of when they hear the word racism, right? Somebody did something to somebody. It includes the different idea, the prejudice, and then the different action, the discrimination. This is where a lot of our interest now in implicit bias is wrapped up in here. Many people call this kind of racism interpersonal racism. That's a good word, too. But I keep calling it personally mediated racism, even though that's quite a tongue twister, because I am still understanding racism as a system. And this is the system mediated through people. How can it impact health? Many examples. Police brutality. I used to talk about, imagine you were pulled over for driving while black or driving while Latino and interpreted as resisting arrest and hit upside the head. Right? That used to be my example. Now I can just give you a litany of names. You can give them back to me. Right? We could talk about Mike Brown or Eric Garner or Walter Scott or Sam DuBose or Sandra Bland or Laquan McDonald or little baby Tamir Rice. We could even talk about Trayvon Martin, not even a police officer. A self-appointed neighborhood watchman who hunted that young boy down because he didn't think he belonged in that neighborhood and killed him. And that affects not only the people who have lost their lives and their families, but it affects whole communities because to the extent that we don't have accountability for these killings of unarmed black and brown men and women, communities are just bracing themselves for the next occurrence. Physician disrespect. That can be as subtle as a physician not giving a patient the full range of treatment options because the physician figures, well, that patient couldn't afford or wouldn't comply or wouldn't understand or whatever the physician assumes. Or it can be quite blatant, like sterilization abuse, which has had many iterations in our nation's history. Shopkeeper vigilance, being followed around in stores, or waiter indifference, not getting quick, respectful treatment. And these are just two examples of what people call everyday racism, you know, kind of the subtle microaggressions, the subtle communication of disrespect, which might even be related to elevated blood pressures in communities of color, blood pressures that don't even go down at night. That last bullet about teacher devaluation, that's a very important manifestation of personally mediated racism, because if a teacher looks at a young child and thinks that child can't learn and puts them off in the ADD track, that child will never even know their full potential, much less have the opportunity to develop to their full potential. And like institutionalized racism, all of these elements of personally mediated racism can be through acts of commission, acts of doing, as well as acts of omission, acts of not doing. But even more important to recognize with this level is that personally mediated racism can be unintentional as well as intentional. You do not have to have intended to do something racist to have had a racist impact. The third level of racism, internalized racism, I define as acceptance by members of the stigmatized races of negative messages about our own abilities and intrinsic worth. Here I'm speaking from the point of view of members of the stigmatized races. It's a one-sided thing I'm giving now. People who do anti-racism training, my friends have said, Camara, what about the internalized sense of entitlement that many white people walk around with? Isn't that also internalized racism? And I agree. I'm not dealing with that today. I'm putting it off with my background, kind of normative, you know, institutionalized racism stuff. So, from the point of view of members of the stigmatized races, how could internalized racism affect our health? Well, self-devaluation, feeling maybe I'm really not as good as, maybe I shouldn't try to graduate from high school, or apply to that college, or apply for that job, or try to live in that neighborhood. In fact, that self-devaluation turns into fratricide, black on black, or Latino on Latino crime. Because if you don't value yourself, you won't value somebody who looks very similar to you, and you would just as soon off them as not. The white man's ice is colder syndrome. That phraseology comes from my parents' generation. And what it meant then, and what it still means today for many people of color, is say you're black and you need a lawyer, you might actually go and try to get a white lawyer over a black lawyer. Or if you needed a doctor, you might seek out a white doctor over a black doctor. In fact, if your lemonade were warm, you might go way down the street to get the white man's ice over the black man's ice, deeply believing that the white man's ice is colder, deeply internalizing the myth of white superiority. Helplessness, resignation, helplessness, hopelessness turns into a lot of self-destructive health behaviors. It even turns into not registering to vote, or not voting even if you are registered. And come on, people, we can't let that happen, right? All hands on deck, right? So, and really, internalized racism is about members of stigmatized races accepting the limitations to our own full humanity of the box into which we've been placed. So that when you hear young high school students of color teasing one of their own who's trying to be the valedictorian by saying, well, you know, so-and-so is just trying to be white, we have to challenge that. Because since when do white people claim exclusive access to excellence? So now I'm going to illustrate these three levels of racism with my gardener's tale. And again, if you've heard this, listen with special ears so that you can tell it back, okay? But before I tell you the gardener's tale, let me tell you what sparked it. Because there was something I saw with my own real eyes, something that happened in my life. So let me tell you what I saw first, and then let's make it a story about racism. So my husband and I, so as Anna said, you know, my husband and I, newly married, we moved back to Baltimore. I'm going to finish my PhD at Hopkins, and we bought our first freestanding house with a big wraparound porch, with flower boxes dotted all around the porch. And it was October when we bought the house, so we weren't thinking about planning anything then. But when spring came, we were all excited, going to decorate the house. So we run out with our marigold seeds, getting ready to plant. And then we looked and we saw that some of the boxes had dirt in them, but some of the flower boxes were empty. So my husband dutifully goes down to the gardening store and he hauls big old bags of potting soil back and we fill up the empty boxes. And then we take equal numbers of our marigold seeds and we put them in all of the boxes and we water them. And truth be told, I'm not the gardener in the family, so at this point I'm exhausted, so I sit back. I'm just going to be delighted. But about 3 weeks later, as I'm walking out of my front door and got to my porch, I looked at those flower boxes and I stopped in my tracks because what I saw made me think that we had planted completely different species in some boxes versus the others. Some of the boxes were full of plants, and they were tall, vigorous-looking plants, and other boxes just had a few plants in them, and they were scrawny and scraggly-looking. And then I realized what had happened. You see, that potting soil that my husband had brought turned out to be rich, fertile soil. So that every single seed planted in the rich, fertile soil had sprouted. The strong seed had grown very tall and vigorous, and even the weak seed had made it halfway up. But that old soil that we found there turned out to be poor, rocky soil. So the weak seed planted in the poor, rocky soil had just died. And even the strong seed in the poor, rocky soil had to struggle to make it to a middling height. And some of you guys are nodding. So there are some gardeners out here, right? And so maybe you've composted half of your garden. Maybe you've seen this with your own real eyes, and the image is about the importance of the soil, the importance of the environment. But now we're going to make this a story about racism by introducing a gardener. So now we're going to have a gardener who has two flower boxes, one which she knows to have rich, fertile, well, poor rocky soil on this side, and one she knows to have rich, fertile soil. And she has seed for the same kind of flowers, except some of the seed is going to produce pink blossoms, and some of the seed is going to produce red blossoms, and the gardener prefers red over pink. So what does she do? She takes the red seed and puts it in the rich, fertile soil. The pink seed she throws over in the poor, rocky soil. And in 3 weeks, she sees in her flower boxes what I saw in mine. In that rich, fertile soil, all the red seed has sprouted. Strong red seed, tall and vigorous. Even the weak red seed has made it halfway up. That poor, rocky soil, weak pink seed has died. Here comes a strong pink seed, struggling, trying to make it. And then in these two flower boxes, those flowers go to seed. And the next year, the same thing happens. And then those flowers go to seed. And year after year after year after year after year, the same thing happens until finally, about 10 years later, the gardener is looking at her flower boxes and she says, well, you know, I was right to prefer red over pink. So we're going to interrupt the story for a moment to say the first part of this story is how institutionalized racism works. When you had the initial historical insult of the separation of the seed into the two types of soil, you had the contemporary structural factors of the flower boxes keeping the soil separate, and then through inaction in the face of need, perpetuation of the inequity. But let's pick the story back up and say, well, where is personally mediated racism in the garden? Well, the gardener's looking over at Red thinking, oh, Red is so beautiful. And then she looks at the pink flowers and she says, oh, they sure are scrawny and scraggly looking. So she plucks off the pink blossoms before they can even go to seed. Or she might notice that a pink seed has blown into the rich fertile soil, so she plucks it out before it can establish itself, which is some of the anti-affirmative action stuff that goes on. And where would internalized racism be in the garden? Well, the red flowers are just living their lives, enjoying being red, many of them either not understanding or acknowledging that they're benefiting from enriched soil. Pink flowers are looking over at red, thinking with all their hearts that they wish they too could be red. You know, mighty fine, right? And here come the bees. And the bees are just minding their own business, collecting nectar, but pollinating at the same time. So here comes a bee, bzzz, into one of the pink flowers, and then bzzz, into another flower, and then bzzz, into another pink flower. And this pink flower's like, get away from me, bee. Don't bring me any of that pink pollen. I prefer the red, because the pink flower has internalized that red is better than pink. So now the question arises, what do we do to set things right in this garden? So we can start out by addressing the internalized racism. So we can go over to the pink flowers and we can say, pink is beautiful, power to the pink. And that is an important intervention. I'm not making fun of it. It is an important intervention, but if that's all we do, it's not going to change the situation in which the pink flowers find themselves. So you can say, okay, let's address the personally mediated racism. Let's have a conversation with the gardener. Or better yet, let's have a workplace multicultural workshop for the gardener. It's all good. So we have our workshop. And in the workshop we say, dear gardener, would you please stop plucking those pink flowers? And maybe she will, and maybe she won't. But even if she does stop plucking the pink flowers, it's not going to change the situation in which they find themselves. I think that if you really want to set things right in the garden, you must address the institutionalized racism, which means you have to either break down the boxes and mix up the soil, or you can keep separate boxes too. That's all right, although in my mind it makes it easier going forward to continue segregating resources, right? But if you keep separate boxes, it means that you need to enrich that poor rocky soil until it's as rich as the rich fertile soil. And when you do that, the pink flowers will flourish. They'll be looking beautiful, grand, and glorious. And in that intervention, you will now have addressed the internalized racism, because pink will no longer be looking over at red, thinking red is better or wanting to be red. And in that intervention, you may also address the personally mediated racism. Now, the original gardener may have to go to her grave preferring red over pink, but her children, who grow up seeing the flowers equally beautiful, will be less likely to have that kind of attitude. So this story has been to illustrate these three levels of racism and to strongly suggest that if you want to set things right in the garden, you need to at least address the institutionalized racism. Good if you address all the levels at the same time. But even in just addressing the institutionalized, the other levels may take care of themselves. But there's an important question that we haven't even raised yet, which is, who is the gardener, right? Because the gardener, after all, is the one that I gave the power to decide, the power to act, or agency, and control of resources. And these three things taken together really, in my mind, are the elements of self-determination. So who is the gardener? Well, government is a huge part of the gardener. In fact, if you've read the paper, you've seen this slide, and it says, who is the gardener? Government, power to decide, power to act, control of resources. That's what I published, but that was before I went to CDC. So then I went to CDC and I have PowerPoint, so I corrected my slide, right? But no, of course, government's a huge part of the gardener, but not the only part, right? Because media, foundations, corporations, even communities, to the extent that they have self-determination, are part of the gardener. But whoever the gardener is, it is dangerous when the gardener is allied with one group. I painted her red. That's why she prefers red over pink. And it's also dangerous when she is not concerned with equity. When she can look at her flower boxes and think that her garden is beautiful because she's not even counting the pink flowers as part of her garden. And so our challenge is what to do about the gardener. Do we make the gardener striped or polka dotted or fuchsia? Do the pink flowers have to grow or recruit their own gardener? Lots of questions that can come out of it. And actually, I'll just lift two before I carry on. One question I was once asked was, Dr. Jones, excuse me, but why should the red flowers share their soil? Now, that question is an important question, first of all, because it shows the power of this story to start conversations about racism. Because if we were talking about racism between you and me, the question would never even come up. But my answer to the question, why should the red flowers share their soil, is that actually, that soil doesn't belong to the red flowers, it belongs to the garden. But here's a second question. What if that's not the original gardener that we're looking at? What if that's the gardener's great-great-great-great-grandchild? Here we are. What then? Because that great-great-great-great-grandchild has grown up seeing the flowers looking like that, may not even think there's an issue to be solved. So there are three quick things I want to say about that. The first is the importance of us making the differences in the height and vigor of the pink and red flowers a problem. We did that on the health side when the 16th Surgeon General, Dr. David Sadger, and then President Clinton announced in 1998 that we were going to try to eliminate racial ethnic health disparities by the year 2010. That was an important agenda setting thing because it changed the national goal setting from, say this is black infant mortality rates and white infant mortality rates. Before then, the goal was to do this. But it made the goal to do this, to eliminate the gap. So that was important. But then we didn't hit that goal. We're in 2016. We did not eliminate racial ethnic health disparities by 2010. And it's not because we didn't put intellect or resources or anything. It's that, you know, this is a huge problem, and we're sort of pruning this weed as opposed to getting to the root. So we need to address root issues. And in particular, if here we are, the gardener's great-great-great-great-grandchild, we need to know about the differences in the quality of the soil. We need to make those flower boxes transparent and be talking about the differences in the quality of the soil. And then, more important than that, if the first thing is to make the differences in height and vigor a problem, the second to make those flower boxes transparent, when we do that, we also need to be very clear that we understand that the pink seed didn't just go jump into that poor rocky soil. We have to talk about history. And we have to talk about the gardener's agency in all of this. And I used to tell this story for years, and it would all be about the differences in the quality of the soil until I recognized one day in the telling that even if we were able to compel the gardener to equalize or actually provide resources according to need, right, between the two flower boxes, if we were to make that happen today, if she continued to prefer red over pink, she would continue to privilege red over pink going forward. So we also have to address not just the opportunity structure piece, the quality of the soil, but also the gardener's valuation piece, the cultural racism, if you will, what some people have described as white supremacist ideology, this notion, this preference for red over pink. We have to address that or we will not have solved the problem. I didn't used to be about values at all. But now I recognize racism as a system of both structuring opportunity and assigning value, and we need to be intentional on both. Now, I want to commend this question to you. How is racism operating here? And first of all, I have to say that racism is not a cloud, it's not a miasma that we can't get a handle on, but it is, as I've described, a system with identifiable and addressable mechanisms, right? And these mechanisms are in our structures, policies, practices, norms, and values, in different elements of decision-making, where the structures are the who, what, when, and where of decision-making, who's at the table and who is not. And every time you find yourself at a decision-making table, you need to look around and say, who is not here who has an interest in this proceeding? And then your job is not just to represent those interests, but also to find them a way to the table. What is on the agenda and what is not? And we're parts of many collectives that have silly agendas. We can put important things on all kinds of agendas, right? And if structures of who, what, when, and where of decision-making, policies are the written how of decision-making. And in addition to reviewing policies, you know, like health impact assessment or, you know, try to do this health and all policy stuff, we also need to look at policies that don't exist. Again, we have to get used to looking at the absence of. And if policies are the written how, then practices and norms are the unwritten how. That's harder to measure and get a hold on. That's the shoulder tapping that gets somebody named to a board. But that's very important. And then values are the why. And as I said, I used to not be about values. I used to think that was some kind of maybe, church thing or something. But it's a public health thing. It's an ethical and public health thing, and we have to be addressing values to untie this big knot. So the definition that I gave earlier of racism can actually be generalized to be a definition of any system of structured inequity. So you could say, what is sexism? That's a system of structuring opportunity and assigning value based on gender. that unfairly disadvantages some, unfairly advantages others, and saps the strength of the whole society through the waste of human resources. Parallel structures for many of these axes of inequity. And there are many axes of inequity that are in our society today, intersecting in communities and in individuals. Here's a partial list. And all of these things are operating at least as risk markers for how opportunity is structured and value is assigned, even as a few of them are operating as risk factors in the progression to disease. So then you might say, well, Camara, I was with you the whole way. Yeah, we got to address racism, but now you just told me all of this other stuff. Why should I address racism over one of these others? And my answer to that is that racism is foundational in our nation's history, and yet many people are in denial of its continued existence and profound impacts on the health and well-being of the nation. So we must address race as the axis of inequity and racism as the system, even as we address, acknowledge, and address these others. And in fact, what we learn from dismantling racism will actually probably have corollary effects, if not instructional effects, for dismantling these other systems. So it's not like I don't understand that there's other stuff going on, but racism is so foundational and invisible that we must address it. So, I started my talk saying that achieving health equity, I'd like to provide a definition of health equity which guides us in addressing any of those systems of structured inequity. So this definition is three parts. What is it? How do we get there? And how is it related to health disparities? And this definition differs somewhat from the Healthy People 2020 definition, to which I also contributed. But see, that one got stuck, you know, after going through clearance once, and I have PowerPoint, so, you know, I can tweak and all. So here's the first thing. What is health equity? Well, health equity is assurance of the conditions for optimal health for all people. Healthy People 2020 starts out that health equity is attainment of the highest level of health for all people, and I agree that that is our goal. But what troubles me with that as the definition of health equity is, what if we hit that last Sunday? Are we done? And in my mind, health equity is not an outcome, but it's a process. And which process? It's assurance, which is actually one of the three core functions of public health that were identified by the Institute of Medicine, along with assessment and policy development. Assurance of what? Of the conditions for optimal health, of the social determinants of health, if you will, and for whom? For all people. That's the equity part. How do we get there? Well, achieving health equity requires at least these three things: valuing all individuals and populations equally, recognizing and rectifying historical injustices, and providing resources according to need. And how is health equity related to health disparities? Health disparities will be eliminated when health equity is achieved. Health disparities is counting the different numbers of different colored bodies at the bottom of the cliff, or the differences in the height and vigor of the pink and red flowers. Health equity is all the stuff that came before. And I actually recognize that we have three huge barriers to achieving health equity in this country. The first of all is that we are ahistorical as a culture. Right? We think that the present is disconnected from the past, that the current distribution of advantage or disadvantage is a happenstance, and that systems and structures are just givens, and they're immutable. They cannot be changed. A second huge barrier is that we have a very narrow focus on the individual in this society. Self-interest is narrowly defined. We don't even think about the interest of our extended families in many instances. We have a limited sense of interdependence. There, but for the grace of God, go I, and you know, all of that. We have a limited sense of collective efficacy. We don't think about joining together in collective. In fact, we are sort of, many people are anti-union, as if that's like a bad thing, right? And when you have a narrow focus on the individual, it means that systems and structures are seen as invisible or irrelevant. They have nothing to do with anything. It's all about the individual. The third huge barrier is this endorsement of what I describe as the myth of meritocracy. The story goes something like this, that if you work hard, you will make it. Now, clearly, most people who have made it have worked hard. Not everybody who's made it has worked hard, but most people who have made it have worked hard. But there are many, many other people who are working just as hard or harder who will never make it because of an uneven playing field. And racism and these other systems of structured inequity structure that uneven playing field. So that when we're in denial of racism, we're endorsing that myth of meritocracy. And in fact, you think about it, in this society, where are we standing? Do we think that two babies are born with equal potential? Or do we think that two babies are born with equal opportunity? If we think that two babies are born with equal potential and then they grow up with uneven outcomes, then we have to look outside to see what is causing that. But if we think that people are born with equal opportunity and then we see uneven outcomes, then we just say, oh, the one who didn't accomplish was lazy or stupid. We have to be careful and dismantle this myth of meritocracy. So strategies for achieving health equity, just very quickly, we need to understand the importance of history, challenge the narrow focus on the individual, expose the myth of meritocracy, and look for successful strategies from outside the U.S. We are also, we have this kind of American exceptionalism view that, you know, we can't learn anything from any place else. But of course, there are many, many other strategies that we need to learn if we're going to try to do better. We also need to acknowledge that systems and structures exist and that they are modifiable. So rather than investing a lot of resources, I'm interested in the gene, but instead of investing so many resources in gene modification without addressing structures as if they were, you know, static, I think we need to do some of both. And we need to not only break down barriers to opportunity, but also build bridges to opportunity. And for example, community colleges are a huge bridge to opportunity. We need to transform from how we train our young people right now to be consumers to training them to be citizens. We need to let them know how government works. We need to encourage them to read widely, to speak more than one language, to travel if they can. We need to create opportunities for them to travel and to see different parts, not just of their city, but of the world. And so this is all about changing opportunity structures. And in terms of that valuation piece, we need to break out of our bubbles to experience our common humanity. Each of us travels in a bubble, our work bubble, our families, maybe we go to a church or a community meeting or whatever, and we often, our bubbles are so thick sometimes that we have no idea that there are people just across town who are just as kind, funny, generous, smart, hardworking as we are, who have very different circumstances. So we need to engineer ways to break through our bubbles. The school can do some of that. In our churches, in our maybe we need to partner a private and a public elementary school, or whatever we need to do. We need to create that so we can know our common humanity, so that we can embrace not just my children versus your children, but embrace all children as our children. So I'm going to give you one more tool. I've given you some tools that are definitions and frameworks and stories and, you know, cartoon. Here's another tool before I close with three more very quick allegories. So who in this room has ever heard of the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination? I see about 10 hands, which is fabulous. This is more than most, so congratulations, you know, Dorsey School of Public Health. It's really great. What is it? It's an international anti-racism treaty that was adopted by the UN General Assembly way back in 1965. Who even knew that there was an international anti-racism treaty? So here's a question for you. Do you think the US has signed this treaty? No, right? Like, who even heard of it? But surprise, 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 yes. The US signed it. But the key, now many of you already are past me on this one, the key is that our diplomats can sign any treaty they want, but it doesn't have force over us until the Senate ratifies it. So that's the trick there. Well, do you think the Senate has ratified this treaty?
Yes.
Yes. Surprise, surprise, surprise. 28 years later, in 1994, the U.S. Senate ratified the treaty. What does that mean? That means that today, we have international treaty obligations to do right under this 9-page treaty. One of the obligations is to submit periodic reports about how we're doing. So every 6 years or so, our State Department submits a report. This last report that you'll find there is about 69 pages long, and it's saying, you know, actually, this third report, this report was written under the current administration, well, you know, the Obama administration, and it was like, I'll just say I didn't read the first. The second one under the Bush administration was, you know, very good. We're the United States. We have laws against these things. This third report is like, we're the United States, we have laws against these things, but sometimes things fall through the cracks, so this is how we're responding. I hope that the fourth report will say, we're the United States, we have laws against these things, and we are not letting anything slip through the cracks. That's really where we need to go. But anyway, so we submitted our third report in 2013, and 82 parallel reports were submitted by other organizations. The School of Public Health, anybody could write a parallel report, and the committee will read it. So the committee considered all of that stuff in August of 2014, and in September of 2014, they sent back to us their concluding observations, which was only 14 pages, so I hope that all of you will read it sometime this week. And the concluding observations go something like this. Dear United States, thank you for your report. We remain concerned about racial profiling, residential segregation, the achievement gap in education, differential access to healthcare, disproportionate incarceration, and on and on and on. And not only do they remain concerned, they actually have specific recommendations that are actionable. And so if you're working with a community group or whatever you're doing, you can review that 14-page thing and find some paragraph that you can latch onto. One of the specific recommendations is that the U.S. adopt a national action plan to combat structural racial discrimination. Wow. And so you may know that the American Public Health Association, actually, under my presidency, we're launching a national campaign against racism. That's not a national action plan, but that's a little piece of something, you know, to get the ball moving. The committee also says, dear United States, please let your people know about the existence of this treaty. They said it before, too. This is not the first time they're making that recommendation. So now every time I talk, I do my part, okay? Right. But anyway, so just to quickly let you know that the American Public Health Association already has an active website, www.apha.org/racism, that has a lot of resources there. It's evolving, but it has the treaty and the concluding observations and stuff. So if you want to just get some resources on racism, you can go there. And coming soon will be the establishment of an anti-racism collaborative with 7 collective action teams. And I'm not going to bore you with the details of this, but look soon, okay? Keep going to that website. I'm going to close with 3 other quick allegories. This first one was sparked by my experience as a medical student when I had been invited to a faculty member's garden party, and it was lovely. The garden was festooned with Japanese lanterns and colored light bulbs, and, you know, as night was falling, you know, there's lots of music and little hors d'oeuvres, and I was having fun, but I got a little weary, and I decided to sit at the edge of the garden as night fell and just let the music and conversation wash over me. And as I sat there, I became fascinated by a group of pink moths. And I was just, you know, zen, you know, it's beautiful. And then my gaze shifted, and I was like, ooh, look at the green moths over there and the blue moths over there. And isn't it interesting how they're sorting according to their kind? And I had that thought for a brief minute. You laugh. She laughed. Yes, she did. She laughed right in my face because she knows I could have been... I could have been at a different part of the garden, and I would have been talking about orange or purple or you know, yellow moths. And you know that moths don't come in these colors, right? Because you've seen moths, the little insects, and you've seen them under a full spectrum light. So you know they are different colors, but they're different colors of tan and brown and speckled and splotched. And the colors that I thought I was seeing and the colors that we do think we see are due to the lights by which we look, where the colored lights distort and mask our own true variability. And this observation just made me think about what is race and how do the racial categories that we construct color our vision of who we are. And it was just a nice little image that illustrates race as a social classification, not a biologic descriptor, as the social interpretation of how one looks in a race-conscious society. And if we're in a society that's hanging up black, white, Latino, other lights, that's what we're going to see. Go to another part of the world and they'll have different kinds of lights. But only when we look under a universal light that admits to all possibility, when we know our full possibility. And what we have in this country today are not just different colored lights. We have different colored lights with nets around them, and we differentially value the different colored lights differently, and the moths are even starting to believe that they are pink or green or yellow. The second image, dual reality of restaurant saga, was also sparked by my experience as a medical student. I was studying in our apartment late with some friends, and we were hungry, and there was no food in the apartment, so we decided we're going to go out and get something to eat. So we walk into town, and we find a restaurant, and we walk in, and we sit down, and the menus are presented, and we order our food, and the food is served, and here we are eating, and it's not very exciting yet. You're like, most people have had that experience, okay? But as I sat there eating with my friends, I glanced across the room and I noticed a sign. And the sign set open. And if I hadn't thought anything more about it, you know, I would have assumed that other hungry people could come and sit down and eat, but I knew something about the two-sided nature of those signs. And I knew that, in fact, the restaurant was now closed due to the hour, and that hungry people just a few feet away from me but on the other side of the sign would not be able to come in and sit down and eat, and all of a sudden, I understood how racism structures open-closed signs in our society. That racism structures a dual reality, and for people who are sitting inside at the table of opportunity eating and they look up and they see a sign that says open, they don't even know that there's a two-sided sign going on. Because it is difficult for any of us to recognize a system of inequity that privileges us. It is difficult for men to recognize male privilege and sexism. It is difficult for white people in this country to recognize white privilege and racism. It is difficult for all Americans to recognize our American privilege in the global context, except we got a little hint of that with Ebola, did we not? And yet for those on the outside, they're very well aware that there's a two-sided sign going on because it proclaims close to them, and yet they can look through the window and see people inside eating. So back inside, to those who say, is there really a two-sided sign? Does racism really exist? I say, I know it's hard for you to know when you only see open. In fact, that's part of your privilege, not to have to know. But once you do know, you can choose to act. So it's not a scary thing. It's an empowering thing. You're not compelled to act, but you are equipped to act. And if you care anything about the people on the other side of that sign, you could even talk to the restaurant owner who's right there inside with you after all, and you could say, why don't you reopen the restaurant? There are hungry people outside. Let them come in. You'll make more money and all the conversations we can have. Or maybe you'll pass some food through the door, break through the glass, or tear down the sign, but whatever you do, you won't be sitting there saying, huh, wonder why those people don't just come on in and sit down and eat, because you'll understand something about the two-sided nature of the sign. And so this is the one I was telling you, if you want to understand how to talk about white privilege or whatever, or somebody asked me earlier today, how do you let people who say there's no racism, how do you even start the conversation? Part of the answer is to have people walk outside of the restaurant and look and see the other side, be in the other people's experience, you know, break through the bubbles. But the other is that this allegory, because everybody can understand, everybody has seen this two-sided sign and can understand that it can exist. And we can all be in our own sides at the table of opportunity, thinking that everybody has our same experience. So now, the last story, Life on a Conveyor Belt, Moving to Action. I'm actually going to move myself. This actually wasn't sparked by my own real life experience, but it was sparked by an image from the book, Why Are All the Black Kids Sitting Together in the Cafeteria? And Other Conversations About Race by Dr. Beverly Daniel Tatum, who just retired as president of Spelman College. So she has an image in her book about racism as basically a passive process, people just living their lives, but they're on a conveyor belt that's moving inexorably through racism and toward racism and all, but they're not trying to be racist, they're just living their lives, okay? So this is how she pictures racism. I'm going to expand on her image to talk about how we can become actively anti-racist. So here, let's put ourselves on the conveyor belt here. We're here after all. So here we are on the conveyor belt, just living our lives, going to school, maybe going to work, and you know, community meetings or whatever, and living our lives because you know, racism is most often passive. And most of us aren't even aware, really, really. I mean, we could be aware. There's a big sign in front of us that says racism, but most of us don't look up. You know, and even if we do look up, we might see racism, and then we close our eyes, right? We're in denial. We're still on that same conveyor belt. Or maybe we look and we're like, oh! You know, and we turn around, right? Because we don't want to acknowledge it, but we don't do anything else, and we're still in that way. Maybe we're colorblind, right? But let's put ourselves in this room today on this conveyor belt to see what can we do? What must we do? So here we are now, we're on the conveyor belt, and all of a sudden we do look up and we see the racism sign and we do not want to go there. So what do? We do have to turn around. But if we don't do anything else, we'll still be drawn into the thing. We have to take a step in the back direction. We have to actually become actively anti-racist. And in fact, if you're on a conveyor belt, you need to walk at least as fast as the conveyor belt is moving just to stay in the same place. And then let me ask you this. What happens when you're walking backwards on a crowded conveyor belt? You're going to start bumping into people, right? And it's going to be uncomfortable for you and for them. And they're going to say, hey, buddy, watch out. Where are you going? Which is your opportunity to do the first of three stages of being actively anti-racist, which is to name racism, to say, do you see where we're going? Do you want to go there? Or will you turn around with me? Now, most people would just say, oh, get out of my way, because they do not want to be disturbed out of their comfort. But maybe one or two will turn. So now you have one or two of you walking backwards on this conveyor belt. You keep bumping into people, and you keep naming racism, right? And you get more and more who will turn. Never 50%, though. Don't even count on that. But now, right, no, I mean, being honest, right? But now, as you build up a critical mass, you don't have to just stay in this same thing. And what do you really want to do? You don't want to just be treading water on this conveyor belt. You really want to get to the motor that's making the belt run, right? So now we're going to make some headway because we have more and more of us. And we see the motor. There it is. And so now it's the importance of doing the second stage of being actively anti-racist, which is to ask the question, how is racism operating here? So I'm looking at the motor, and I think it's this lever. So I'm going to grab the lever. And the whole thing starts shaking, and I've done it. Except racism is very fancy, so it reconfigures itself and it keeps on moving. So that highlights the importance of the third stage of being actively anti-racist, which is to organize and strategize to act. Because as I'm pulling on the lever, then I need you to push a button, and I need somebody else to spin a dial, and I need somebody to swing that pendulum, whatever it takes. And I really believe that all of us working together can dismantle this system and put in its place a system in which all people can know and develop to their full potentials. And that is my challenge to you, and that is our challenge together. And I hope that you will join me, and thank you very much for letting me share these thoughts with you. If there are a lot of questions, I don't know how it's working. Is there a single mic? Oh, there's a mic here. I would suggest that people line up at the mic, and I'm happy to hear people's all the questions at once and then answer them all at once so that we can hear the questions, because often questions are more important. But if there's only one or two, then we'll take them aside. Okay.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is John Kirby. I'm the Director of Community Health and Wellness at a health center not far from here that Drexel co-facilitates with another organization. So that's the 11th Street Family Health Services. In doing my work, I often get frustrated. Right now we have a group started there called Undoing Racism, where we're actively looking for those things. We're hiring a new director, so we've looked at what's in the system, and we've seen that the three people who do the hiring were three white people at the top, and we asked ourselves, what could really change if the three people who always make the decisions look the same probably think a lot the same, right? Which makes me start to think that something else needs to change. The people at the top will probably have to change, which gets to this uncomfortable reality that something needs to look different, and the people who are at the top have to agree that something needs to look different, and then often start to step back, right? How do we do that? How do we get to the point where the people who are privileged decide to say, you know what, I'm going to step back from that privilege and let somebody else have a spot. And I know we have affirmative action and people who are fighting against it, but what's the actual next step? How do we get people to realize that there's a look that has to be achieved and we actually have to work to achieve it? It won't just happen. We have to actively put the people in the place to make the difference.
Right, and I think that part of, thank you for that question. So part of it is, how invested are the people in the top in the success of the operation versus in their own position? Because if there is buy-in that we really want to change things, then at some point they'll have to recognize that they might have to give up their own personal privilege so that the whole system can work. I mean, it's the same story. It's about, you know, do they recognize that part of them being there might actually be hurting the organization? And it's hard for people to acknowledge that for themselves, because all of us are trying to do our best, honestly. All of us are trying to do our best, and it's hard to think that I may not be the best one for this role at this time. So that's going to take a lot of real conversation. But if those people really are interested in the success of what you're trying to do, then the truth of what you're observing will become manifest to them. But sometimes it's hard. So it's going to be a lot of hard work of continuing a fearless discussion and saying it's not about you as a person, but it's about maybe your life experience is not full enough, or there's not enough room to bring other people, or you know that this isn't working, there's some other way that you can contribute to this. But the fear, honestly, the fear of many white people in this country when you start talking about racism is they can say, okay, there's unfair disadvantage and then there's normal. This is the view, right? There's not like unfair disadvantage and then unfair advantage. And the view is there's unfair disadvantage and then there's normal. So, okay, I'll try to help you fix the unfair disadvantage, but don't move me, don't touch me. Hold me harmless. And yet, even as they as individuals are unfairly advantaged, the whole system is being sapped of its vitality because of the situation. So it takes a focus beyond individual placement in this to understand systems thinking, if you will, and a commitment to improving the system. And actually, even if you might shift a little bit in your own personal advantage, the whole system is going to be doing so much better, and you'll have more friendships and less fear, and all, you know, like things will get better. This system is not doing well for any of us, really, except a few people are, their advantage as individuals, but the whole thing is rotten. Yes.
Hi, Dr. Jones. My name is Sanaa Imam, and I'm a first-year MPH student here at Dorsey School of Public Health. And I commonly feel like addressing social justice issues with regards to healthcare commonly happens in public health settings and not so much in medical settings. And so my question to you is, how do you think the medical education should change to make students more informed of their implicit biases? And then how do you handle pushback from professors who say, oh, well, the medical curriculum is hard enough, we don't need to be adding more classes to that, when seeking to include teachings on racism within a med school curriculum?
So I think that we definitely should be talking about unconscious bias. We should also be talking about structural things. That means that some people only get into health, like hospitals with certain services, or some populations, you know, teaching hospitals in some kinds of neighborhoods, and then the private hospitals and others. So we need to not only talk about the implicit bias stuff, the unconscious bias stuff, but we need to talk about structural stuff as it affects medical care. So we need to be broad there. And so again, it's going to be either different people with different training coming up to be the professors, because you might have a lot of, you know, older people. We might have to let the original gardener die off, but we can't let the original gardener, die off without raising up the gardener's children, or the gardener's children who don't, you know, if we don't let them know about history, don't let them travel down the street to see other people's gardens and how things are done, right, then you're going to have the same thing. So I think that medical educators are becoming more and more aware of the importance of putting social justice issues into medical curriculum. I spoke for AMSA a little while ago, and I also spoke for a New York City coalition of residents and students to dismantle structural racism. That's what they called their thing. So in the young folks, there is a call, and I think that the professors and all need to heed that call. But even if they don't, it's a longer thing, but eventually they'll be replaced. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Linda Wright Moore, and I'm an advisor to the dean and a former reporter who always has a question. I guess the thing that I'm thinking about, and this comes in the context of what's going on in this political season, where we're, I think the way we're framing this out now is that there are a lot of angry working class, middle class people who have seen their wages and their quality, quality of life erode over the past 30 years, et cetera, and they're angry. And there's someone that shall remain nameless who has spoken to them and reached them. And what I feel from the kind of dialogue and the kind of divisive back and forth is that we are in a zero-sum game, that indeed if we make our society in terms of health and other things more equitable, so that more and everyone can live better lives and have higher levels of well-being, that means somebody's going to lose, that when the unearned privilege, if it is relinquished, it means that, you know, I'll be the one who's down and out. And I feel like that's an undercurrent, and that there's not a value on the collective value of doing things to lift all boats. So
right. Where
do you see that going, both in the political sense and also the public health?
Again, I think that is a big fear. To the extent that people start identifying with one another and with one another's struggles, then we can all win. So I think that, I was talking to students earlier today, and we were talking about the conveyor belt, and the question arose, what about people who don't see the racism sign? They see, you know, job loss, they see, other things like that, and they would say there's no racism sign there, that it's not about that, that all of what the clarion call is not about race or racism at all, it's about other things, their anger or whatever. And my answer to that is that the racism sign is still there, it's very evident in our system, but people are looking around it at these other signs, but what we need to, and they're saying that's just a vestigial sign, that maybe the racism sign is there, but it's vestigial, it doesn't really exist anymore. So what we need is for people to really understand. So I think some of the storytelling helps, but I think that for people to really get out and know one another, I'm so clear that this understanding our common humanity and bursting bubbles, but we don't have those opportunities. We're watching different television stations. We're reading different news media. We live in very different communities. And near the twin, because of residential segregation, with all of the historical stuff behind that and all the structural stuff behind that. And so it's going to take a real effort. It's not going to happen passively. I believe that people, I know there's a lot of hateful stuff going on. I believe that people are born good. I do not believe that people are born hateful or racist. I think it's like living near a cement factory that's spewing cement dust, and if you live here long enough, you'll have cement dust in your lungs, and all of us have this cement dust of racism in our lungs. Most of mine is against people who look like me, but all of us have this. And what we have to do, first of all, is if we're having trouble breathing, not blame the person next to you for that trouble breathing, but to identify the cement factory as the cause. We need to put on gas masks, that is, we have to become actively anti-racist, not just for ourselves, but then to band together to go into the factory and turn it off. But if you think that your shortness of breath from that cement dust, if you're blaming the one down here, we'll never get there. So I don't have the real answer of how do we make systems more evident. I talked about those three barriers, you know, the ahistorical nature of things. So how do we get people to read history? So I don't know, maybe we do ads on TV about history, but which TV stations will buy them? I don't know. We certainly need to be teaching history in our schools, but that's the first thing. The second thing is, how do we expand beyond the narrow focus on the individual that's strong here? And how do we explode this myth of meritocracy? Those are huge barriers. I invite other people to think creatively about that. But what we're trying to get to achieve any kind of equity is valuing all individuals and populations equally, recognizing and rectifying historical injustices, and providing resources according to need. What happens when you do not acknowledge differences in need? What happens when you think that I'm the neediest? You haven't even walked out to see other need. You don't think that you're well off, even though you might be very well off compared to other things. So part of it is to connect with one another and stop segregating. Stop being an iPod culture. We used to listen to the radio, huh? And all of us listened to the same songs. Well, you guys don't know. Many of you guys don't know. But in the day, you would turn on the radio, and if you're driving across country, you just listen to the music that's in that part of the world. And now we each have our own private music that we program. We're becoming more and more sealed off from one another. And we have to counter that. We need to become more connected with one another and with one another's realities and one another's struggles. I don't know how. That's the what. I don't know how.
Hi, I'm Robert Watts, Department of English and Philosophy. I really appreciate your stories and the allegories and all. So my question has to do with, it was the New York Times report yesterday that reported some astonishing good news that the black life expectancy was the closest, or the gap between black and white life expectancy was the narrowest it's been ever in recorded history, and that it wasn't just that white life expectancy had declined. There were like massive numbers, a massive drop in black cancer rates and all kinds of homicide rates. Black males are one of the only groups that doesn't have an increased suicide rate recently. How do you account for this? I mean, it's you know, the recession wiped out a lot of black wealth and a lot of incomes. It was devastating, and yet somehow on some of these health measures, there was some progress made.
So I actually heard about the thing, but I've been traveling so much, so I haven't read either the scientific paper or the New York Times thing. It's still the fact that black life expectancy is below whites. So, I mean, even though they're the closest, you still have that gap. So it's not that black went up here and white went down there. So we still have some work to do, unless we presume that it's all right to have that gap. You know, so the narrowing of the gap is good news. I actually haven't looked at it closely to know, you know, what years, what data, you know, is it national and stuff like that, so I can't answer it well. But I will say that people who've been so focused on the decline in middle age white life expectancy and put out a warning about that, it's important for us to notice the decline in anybody's life expectancy, but to focus on that without understanding that the black life expectancy is way down here is not being paying attention, is not an equity lens. It's not an equity lens because you're not valuing all people equally. You're more concerned about this trajectory as opposed to the real gap. So I'm heartened to know that the gap is narrowed. It's not yet closed. We will really know when we have eliminated health disparities when you have random variation around zero in terms of life expectancy gaps or any kind of income gap. It's not even that you're trying to say, oh, well, how close do the values have to get before we've eliminated health disparities? They will only be eliminated when the differences are fluctuating randomly around zero, and we have not gotten there yet.
Thank you so much for your talk. It was very inspiring. My name is Jonathan Pirtle. I'm faculty here in the school, and I have a question about the gardener's children. So I'm a white male, right, middle class, grew up middle class, highly educated, and I have an 8-month-year-old son at home who is also white. His father's a professor. I want him to be a good gardener, and I want his little friends to be good gardeners. What advice do you have for me in terms of how we raise our children to change these structural inequities?
The first is to talk about racism with your children, and most white people grow up never talking about racism around their family tables. People of color do talk about racism. They try not to lead with that, but they try to also equip their children. No, I mean, honestly, right? Am I speaking the truth, right? But you try to equip your children so if your child comes in and says, well, so-and-so called me a bad name, you say, well, you know, that's a reflection on them, not you, or if you, you know, can I have straight hair, mommy? Oh, well, you know, you try to bring the pictures, or, you know, and the books and all, and, you know, kind of the black art and stuff like that. And then when they're in middle school and so-and-so, you know, got this award and, you know, I did just as well. And you say, well, okay, it's like a basketball game with an unfair ref and you just have to work twice as hard to win in that game. And, you know, so there's lots of different means and stuff that we use. But we're used to talking about racism with our children. And then when the killings of unarmed young black men happen, then you have the conversation about how to deal with the police, how to walk, how fast you should walk or not walk. You know, like somebody I heard did an article of how fast should a black man walk? Because if he walks too fast, he looks like he's running from something, and if he walks too slow, he's learning. You know, like, I mean, there are things, but you talk to your kids about these things. And white people are not equipped to do it, but the best thing you can do is to talk to your kids about racism. So especially when a question comes up, I am imagining that, you know, when the levees broke in New Orleans and there was all of the flooding and everything around Hurricane Katrina, that a young child might say, mommy, why are all the kids on the roofs, or why are all the people on the roofs black? And then that would be your opportunity to talk about who was able to get out and who had the transportation and stuff like that. And you could talk about those things. But I imagine that many parents might have said, oh, well, you know, I don't know, don't pay attention and just go on because you're not equipped. So you have to seek out how to talk about racism. And there are some books. There's a book, Amazing Grace, about a little girl. Get that book if you have young kids. That can start conversations about both racism and sexism. But you have to also maybe seek out friends of color who can help you know how to talk about these things. You know, be in collective or, you know, join a, you know, whatever, a black church or whatever. I mean, but get equipped. Because if you really want to know, then you're going to have to talk to them about racism. Otherwise, they will grow up. And then somebody in a lecture like today will say racism exists, and then they'll be like, well, shoot, if it really exists, wouldn't my parents have talked to me about this? So I would say the three things are to name racism. You know, the three overall things for us is to name racism, ask how is racism operating here, and organize and strategize to act. But it starts with the naming of racism, saying the whole word, not even just race, but racism, because the ism, you can get it out, racism, ism. Is the system that makes race pertinent. And that's the advice.
Yeah. I'm just going to squat instead of changing the microphone itself. Michael Lavasser, I'm a doctoral candidate in the Department of Epidemiology here. I have a question about race, racism, and data operationalization. I'm a data dork. I'm assuming you're a data dork as well. I'm assuming we're all data dorks, right? So do you think the current sort of data definition of race is useful, sort of like what the Census Bureau uses? If not, how would you change it? And in terms of this perception of race being the important determinant, how would you ask that in a survey? How do other people perceive your race? And then sort of the same question about capturing racism as a construct and how people experience racism.
So we at CDC developed a 6-question reactions to race module that was piloted in 2002 on the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance System, which is a phone survey each of the states does. They have 3 parts, the core questions, they have the optional modules and the state-added questions, and it's, for each state it's a population-based survey. And so the 6-question module includes the question, how do other people usually classify you in this country? Would you say white, black, Hispanic, American Indian, or Alaska Native, Native Hawaiian, or other Pacific Islander, Asian, or some other group? So what we did was we took the Office of Management and Budget race categories as well as the Office of Management and Budget ethnicity category and put them all in as ways that people are classified. So it's capturing the on-the-street classification of people in our current society, you know, the kind of classification that doesn't require somebody to say, well, excuse me, how do you self-identify? Or excuse me, where were you born? Where were your parents born? Or excuse me, may I have a little bit of your blood? You know, I have a genetic hypothesis or whatever, but it's that on-the-street race. So I find that to be a useful question. And in 2008, we published in Ethnicity and Disease a very interesting paper. We wanted to entitle it The Health Benefits of Living White, but it was entitled Using Socially Assigned Race to Probe White Advantages in Health Status. But what it looked at was that there were 3 groups who self-identified as non-white but had a significant proportion of people who were usually classified by others as white. So for his people who said, are you Hispanic or Latino? They said yes. So their self-identified race ethnicity was Hispanic or Latino. 63% were usually classified by others as Hispanic or Latino, but 27% usually classified by others as white. When you looked at their self-rated health, like how would you rate your health? Excellent, very good, good, fair, or poor? If you looked at their self-rated excellent or very good health, if you said self-identified Hispanic, other people think you're Hispanic. Self-identified Hispanic, other people think you're white. Self-identified white, other people think you're white. Large and statistically significant difference between Hispanic, and Hispanic-white, but between Hispanic-white and white-white, no evidence of difference. Next group, American Indians. How do you usually, you know, are you Hispanic or Latino? No. Which one or more race would you say is your race? Only one, American Indian. So this is like not me with my Cherokee great-grandmother. This is like somebody purebred, like calling themselves Indian. The groups are Indian, Indian-white, white-white, same thing. And then the other group was of more than one race. Are you Hispanic or Latino? No, which one or more race? They picked more than one race. The groups were more than one race black, more than one race white, white, white. Same thing. So being classified by others as white trumped. Oh, no, no. Excuse me. beat out, right? the so-called self-identified race affinity that is learned. So we call that socially assigned race, and I recommend that. Yes.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. So I work at a nonprofit, and I found that in all of the nonprofits I work at, there's a lot of structural racism at play. All of the people, the large majority of the people at the top of the organization are white, and a lot of the people working in lower level, lower paid positions are people of color. And my organization is amazing in that we actually had a diversity workshop that everyone participated in, and we named race. Everyone talked about how race plays out in the organization, and a lot of people of color talked about the issues they faced. And there's been minimal follow-up, so I see that racism was named. There was an initial discussion of how it's operating, but not too in-depth. And I'm wondering, I'm honestly thinking about trying to set up a work group of some sort at my organization to address it, and I'm wondering how to convince people, the white people at the top. Is anyone from my organization here? Oh, great, I was gonna talk to her tomorrow.
Cool. That's what you got to do. No, that's what you got to do. In fact, as a
Well, I'm really glad to use Zakiya.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering how to bring that up and convince people that it's really important.
So it sounds like you already went to a step, and now people think they're sort of done, like they did that, right? And now everything is solved, that whatever the little bubble was that needed to be burped has been burped. And so this is what I tell everybody. If you want to start addressing racism, I like my gardener's tale, you know. So I'm going to tell you about that. It's 4 pages. It's published 4 pages. It's 2 pages front and back. If you say, I know we already had this racism thing, but I just heard this other story. I don't know if you already used it, but say, let's have a brown bag lunch. Let's come back to this. Then, in that lunch, the way that people talk about the gardener's tale will let you know where they are. And you may find some unexpected allies. Then, the two of you guys and whoever else you find come together, and then you make a plan. But this is how, wherever you are, you can identify allies in a kind of surreptitious way, without assuming allies and without assuming not allies. You may have some people that you never thought were your allies. You need to talk about it, and the way people talk about it will self-identify. So you have to keep on. You have to put in something structural. There are many anti-racism trainers. I like the People's Institute for Survival and Beyond. They're email address is pisab.org. They come in and they do a 2.5-day workshop, but there are others too. And they have gone, they've worked with the city of Flint, they've worked with the Boston Public Health Commission, they've worked with lots of different institutions across the country. And so that tends to steep people more in a 2.5-day process and then try to develop an action plan going forward. But it's an uncomfortable space and it requires continuing action. So you're right. Whatever you have to do, you have to continue it. You can't let it lie. So congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Good afternoon. My name is Jabri. I'm a first-year Master of Public Health student in Health Management and Policy. So I guess what my question is, when we talk about dismantling racism and what that looks like, it's almost as if we talk about it in the theoretical space, because we really don't have a blueprint for what this looks like, because racism has been ingrained in us as a society since inception. So it's like when we dismantle it, it's like we also recognize that this can actually create anarchy, because of what you said in terms of if you pull the lever, then there's a button that we have to press or a window that we have to close. So it's like, how do we dismantle it and not create anarchy, but also really just do something that we don't even know what it looks like outside of theory?
So I think that we can, so I agree with you. I agree with you that people feel uncomfortable. At least we have the devil we know type of thing, you know, and like what's going to happen. But there are, we can learn from different parts of the world. So even though we don't know here, there in New Zealand, I was there for 8 months studying. So Maori are the indigenous New Zealand people, and Paki is sort of the nickname for white British. It's not an insult. So anyway, so it's just kind of the British, I mean the Maori term for British. So I was there looking at Maori Pakeha health disparities. And my question was, can treaty settlements reverse the impacts of racism? So there, the Maori Pakeha health disparities are similar in degree and nature to black-white health disparities here. They had, however, a whole process because the country was established with the Treaty of Waitangi in 1848. It was supposed to be an equal partnership between Maori chieftains and the British Crown. The British in the 1870s were just trouncing all over the treaty. In the 1970s, they said, oops, we trounced all over the treaty. So they said, okay, we're going to allow treaty claims to be brought for any breaches going forward. And then a few years later, when the Labour government came in, it says, we're going to review treaty breaches all the way back to when the treaty was signed. It opened up a whole big process. There was a Waitangi tribunal, which was speaking into the record, the history, and there were, you know, a lot of records made, all of this, and then there was a treaty settlement office. So when the government said, we're going to accommodate all treaty breaches, they also took some land and made it state land, so that was not going to be available. But there were some real things, that, you know, so there was one tribe, one iwi in the south that got a lot of their land back. There was a whole thing about communication and stuff. They were willing to face the history and then to make settlements, but that in and of itself is not enough, because even if they settled things today, if they did not have active involvement of Maori people going forward at all levels of government, then the thing would recreate itself. But that model, Maori people patterned their struggle over the black civil rights struggle. If you go there today, you'll see young people with Malcolm X hats and all of that kind of stuff. But they kept on. When our leaders were killed, then we got derailed. They kept on. The Maori language used to be dead. It's flourishing now. There are parents who will have their kids in Maori kindergarten, elementary, high school, all the way through university, never in an English-speaking school because they know that they can learn English outside, but they have the confidence to do the Maori thing, right? We don't have that confidence in terms of different groups, but that is one example. Then you could maybe look at what's happening in Cuba. None of these places is perfect, but you can look at what different kinds of things have been put in place. We, with our American exceptionalism, think that we have to create it all de novo for ourselves, but there are international models that we can look at, and we need to try. We need to try something. There was one last question. One last, come on. That is the last, right? No creeping up again. Okay.
Good evening. Thank you so much for your talk. I'm Nilanjana. I'm a first-year MPH student. So my question is something about what you mentioned, that poverty and racism are kind of intertwined, and at many levels that there is overrepresentation of certain races on the poverty scale. So if I have to think about it from an intervention point of view, so if I'm thinking of breaking the cycle of poverty, am I also answering breaking the cycle of racism? Or should I think about these two things that are completely different, two parallel roads? Or should I think, or can I think of these two things collectively? Because I'm from India, where what we talk about as racism in this country, we change the term to casteism, where we have divided our own nationality into different levels, our own people, and they are all from India. They are from the same country, same nationality, same origin, but they are yet divided into different societal class. And I feel like the intervention has again and again gone back to answering the poverty scale and not the casteism.
Right. So I thank you for that question. The first thing I want to say is that I agree with you that casteism and racism are the same thing. And in fact, at the 2001 World Conference Against Racism, the UN World Conference Against Racism, Racial Discrimination, Xenophobia, and Related Intolerance, that the U.S. supposedly boycotted, but we were there. Anyway, but there were signs of Dalits, you know, the untouchable caste, and they had signs that said, casteism is racism, when in fact, I think it's the other way around. I think that racism is casteism based on phenotype, and then the casteism there you have is based on family origin or whatever, and there are many levels of casteism. So they are the same thing. And I think that you have to try to address both at the same time, that if you just try to do the poverty thing without addressing the underlying structural things that are put in place to shunt people into different possibilities, then you have to get those mechanisms of institutionalized racism or casteism. So if you truly value all individuals and populations equally, you know, how do you make that manifest? Well, it's who do you involve in the decision-making table? What do you do when you have like a missing child of one race versus another? How do you respond? How do you invest in communities and that kind of thing? If you really recognize and rectify historical injustices, and if you really provide resources according to need, then that will help you in both. That will help you with the poverty and the other thing, but you have to be willing to dismantle systems. So thank you all very much. Thank you.
For a terrific session and the wonderful discussion from all of you. And please join us for our reception right outside, and you'll have an opportunity to keep talking about this.